Afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Sociology 101, The Individual in Society. I'm Dr. Sharon Squires, and I'm going to be your professor for this course. This course is serving a lot of functions, so I want to start off by talking about the different people who are enrolled in the course. And so, first of all, this course is part of the Young Scholar Program at California State University, Dominguez Hills. High school students with a B average or better can enroll in two classes and earn up to 6 units of college credit for only $3.50. This semester, we're offering 4 courses. Music 101, Introducing Music, on Mondays from 3 to 4:30 p.m. Theater 100, Television, Film, and Theater, on Tuesdays from 3 to 4:30 p.m. Sociology 101, this class, on Wednesdays from 3 to 4:30 p.m. And CHS 100, The Americas, on Thursdays from 3 to 4:30 p.m. Enrollment for the Young Scholars Program is open until Friday the 11th, and if you would like more information or an application if you're in high school, please give us a call at 310-243-2288. So first I'd like to say welcome. Welcome, Young Scholars. Welcome to Sociology. And for the folks that are not in the Young Scholars Program, this class also serves as a standard Sociology 101 class. So some of you are registered for this class for an internet class with me. And then also, there are a couple of other sociology classes, Sociology 101, Sections 1 and 2, that are just tuning in to the lectures for the time being until we begin to meet back in the class during the semester. And so, pretty much for everyone, it's the exact same sociology class. And so the assignments will be the same, the expectations and everything will be the same. And what I want to do first is go over the syllabus, and then I just want to do kick off with an introductory lecture. And so, first of all, we do have a TA for this class. His name is Stephen Hayes, and you will be hearing from him soon. He's going to send out something and just send out an announcement. If you have comments, questions, or issues, you'll be able to email him directly. For this class, there's a couple of things we want to accomplish. We want to be able to define sociological concepts. And so your exams and the things we talk about will be focused on highlighting these concepts that they bring up in the book. We want to understand major theorists and paradigms. And so I am often going to play devil's advocate because there's often several different ways of looking at one thing. We want to understand the different institutions and their functions in society, and so we're going to stop and take a look at religion and some of the other institutions that we all share when we share a collective society. But then I want you to use your sociological imagination, and I'll go into a little bit of detail, but that's just being a little bit more critical about the social world. And then finally, I want you to be able to apply the scientific methods to human behavior. So we're going to talk about how you study people, what would be the appropriate way of getting information, etc. So we've got a lot of goals, but it is an intro class, so everything is designed for you to be able to really find it in your book or the stuff in the lecture topics. We have one book for this class. During the course of the semester, I may send out notes to check out a website or something else online, but most of the readings will come from the Cornbloom textbook, and we are using the 8th edition. I did make a note that if you can't afford the 8th edition, you can use the 7th one. You just have to make sure that the information matches between the two sections and that you're reading the right chapters. When you click on the syllabus, when it talks about the textbook study site, if you click on that link, it brings up a couple of things. First of all, it brings up the support site for the book. So even if you don't have the book and you click on that link, you can get chapter summaries, flashcards, also pop quizzes that will help you with the exam. I sometimes take questions from the internet pop quizzes on this site. So it's worthwhile to click in and take a look at it. And also, it gives you a little box that tells you how you can actually purchase the book one chapter at a time. So when I looked at it, it was as low as $6.40 per chapter. And so we're not reading all the chapters of the book, so you might want to calculate if it would be cheaper to order it per chapter or order the whole book. That's just up to you. And I usually leave it for people to order online and all of that just simply because it's a lot cheaper sometimes, but I will put some copies of the book at the bookstore. The best way to reach me, of course, is through email and also live when we are meeting on Wednesday afternoons. And I'm not going to go through the entire syllabus or anything like that, but just to give you an overview. You will have three exams, and the exams are going to be multiple choice. And like I said, go through those study pop quizzes, look at that site. That will be very helpful to you. And so the class is worth about 600 points total. I want to outline the topics for you. Today we're going to do an intro and just do an overview of sociology. The next week we're going to talk about sociological research. How do you go about studying groups? What do sociologists do in order to study people? Then we're going to talk about culture. How are you constrained or confined by your culture? And for the culture discussion, we also have a corresponding assignment. And that's your first assignment, and it's actually worth 25 points. There might be a typo that says 20 points, but it's 25 points. And what I'd like for you to do is look for something that symbolizes American culture to you. What is it? But you can't use the flag, you can't use the Statue of Liberty or the World Trade Center. Those are too easy. Pick something else. Could it be apple pie, baseball, and attach a picture and write it up and upload it to Blackboard. And we'll talk about what is culture. The next thing we'll talk about is socialization. How did you come to be the way you are? How did you learn to talk? How did you learn to interact? And what would happen if there was a little glitch in that process? We'll talk about that. We'll also talk about deviance, because most of us conform every day. I conform today. I didn't speed on the highway. I conformed to the speed limit. And we never think about deviance. And so you have another assignment also worth 25 points. Commit a deviant act. I want you to go out and break a simple norm or folk way. Like when you have to cough, normally you cover your mouth. What do you do? First, you'd be spreading out rabies H1N1, but you would also be breaking that contract with the others in the society. They expect you to behave this way. What if you went to a restaurant and ate the food with your fingers? Now, that's not a crime. It's not that serious, but you might be surprised how serious people take it in that restaurant. So I'm going to have you go out and be deviant for a second. We're also going to talk about race. What is a race? We think we're in a race. You believe that when you woke up, you had a certain racial assignment. Well, why do you believe that? And how did we get an understanding of, quote, race that we have? And for that discussion, you have to get online, and I want you to take something called the racial bias test. And there's a link on the syllabus. When you click on the link, it should take you right to the site. And you want to do the demonstration test. And what this test is, kind of like your subconscious racial biases. And many of you will not like your results. and I want you to take the test, and I'll be posted to Blackboard, and we'll talk about it. And you might be surprised at your results, actually. Then we'll talk a little bit about religion. And that's actually my favorite chapter. We're going to talk about the snake handlers and all these different belief systems. But everybody's religion works the same way for everybody, regardless of how unique or interesting it is. And for the religion assignment, there's an opportunity to earn some extra credit points. In this class, you can earn, I think, I have it as 20. Maybe 20 or 10 extra credit points, 20. And so throughout the course of the semester, I'm going to just be throwing out different things you can do in order to get those points. Each thing's worth 5 points, so you can do up to 4. For the religion one, design your own religion. What would you worship? Why would you worship? What would be sacred? What would not be sacred? And the interesting thing about this is that you could actually do this for real and create your own religion right now, and probably there'll be people who will follow you. So we're going to talk about that in terms of religion. Then we're going to talk about food and environment. What are you eating? Do you even know what you're eating? And so we're going to look at what you're eating, what's going on with the environment, what are we doing to our DNA. We're going to talk about technology and the fact that, you know, for some people, you can't pry that cell phone or that little device away from them anymore. So how is technology and also the media impacting our contemporary reality? So we have a lot to do. We have a lot to do, and it is often very, very fun to go through some of these things. I'm a visual sociologist, so I usually have a lot of films, a lot of different images, and you'll be able to see that I'll post different things and suggestions also online. So let's get started and get rid of the kind of technical stuff for now. What is sociology? So we want to start off with an introduction. What is a sociological imagination? What does all of this mean? Usually people take sociology because they think it's easy. They're like, well, I'm a people, sociologists study people, so it must be really easy. But in reality, it's a little more complicated than people think. So first, sociology is the systematic study of social behavior and human groups. It includes attitudes, behaviors, and material artifacts. So to sum that up, sociology involves everything that humans do, everything that humans create, everything that humans produce, all the interactions that humans have. And they're so diverse that you can never run out of things to study if you're sociologists. C. Wright Mills talked about something called the sociological imagination. And Mills said, this is an awareness of the relationship between the individual and the wider society. And so when you think about yourself, you think, everything I do, it's about me, you know, I'm unique and creative. But Mills and the sociologists said, well, but you function in a larger social setting. And so you need to understand where you fit in that larger setting. And sociology is the sociological imagination is a conscious effort in a way to also question the obvious, things that you would take for granted. And we often say that sociology moves beyond common sense. Let me give you an example. If you tuned in, I was sitting here and I was in tears, bawling, crying, tissues, everything. Why might I be crying? I could be hurt. Someone might have just stolen my purse. Someone might have just passed away. There's all kinds of things, but I also could have just won the lottery, and I was about to sit here and tell you that I will not be back into this class, and I'm crying tears of joy. So you can't assume you understand my behavior. You kind of have to look at it in the context, and this is what the sociological imagination challenges you to do. Mills says you have to see the relationship between the social conditions and your own life situations. And so at the end of the semester, last assignment is kind of like a time capsule assignment. I want you to imagine that everything is destroyed right now, today. The only thing left is your living space, your apartment, your dorm room, whatever you want to use. And it's been destroyed, the world is destroyed, 3,000 years pass, people run across your place. Kids play, find a hole in the ground, and there is your place perfectly intact. What would your living space tell people about our contemporary society? And so this is the last assignment, so at the end, I want you to be really introspective and look at where you fit in terms of the larger picture. And that's related to Mills. And basically, Mills says, look, this imagination allows you to kind of explore social reality. And we'll talk about what is social reality. And Mills says there are three important questions that you have to ask yourself if you want to have the sociological imagination. One, what is the structure of this particular society as a whole? So what does the society look like? Who's exalted? What institutions exist? What is the context? So that's the first thing. Then he says, where does this society stand in human history? And think about the stages. You talk about the feudal stage, the industrial stage, the technological stage. Now we're going to virtual. Well, all of those stages has a real impact on what the humans do during that time. During the feudal time, during the lords and whatever, it took forever to get a letter across just to maybe the village. It took a week by horse. Now we instantly communicate. So when you talk about where this society stands in human history, we're on the verge of Star Trek. And so we have to understand what does that mean. And then the last question he says are, what are the varieties of men and women that now prevail in this society? So who exists here? Are these people inherently good? Are they inherently evil? In essence, what is the nature of human nature for the people we're studying? And so these questions are going to kind of guide the entire class, the entire semester. So let's go to our first clip. Let's start off with our president, because his speech starts off by talking about what he sees in his one voice speech as America. So let's take a look at our first clip.
Well, I say to them tonight, there is not a liberal America and a conservative America. There is the United States of America. There is not a black America and a white America and Latino America and Asian America. There is the United States of America. The pundits have discussed the House of Commons.
Justice and peace and freedom and equality. And these are the kind of questions you ask yourself. Is this a realistic view of America, really? Or is this very idealistic? And throughout the course of the semester, we'll find out. Well, let's take a look at another reality. Because what I want to do also is bring in some global things to begin to make you Think about the difference between your reality and the reality of someone else. So let's take a look at clip number 2, Kids and Chocolate.
Sweet taste of chocolate. Don't you just love waking up to a fresh cup of hot chocolate right before school? Or enjoying the full taste of chocolate in the afternoon as soon as the school bell rings? But sometimes, there's an ingredient in chocolate that should never be there. This ingredient is called child flavor. Day in and day out, children in the Ivory Coast of Africa wake up with those words and count their teachers. The Ivory Coast makes up more than 20% of the global production of cacao. It is estimated that 109,000 children are working on these plantations, and 7,000 are victims of human trafficking or enslavement. They work in large conditions, are treated poorly, and use very dangerous tools. But most of all, they never get a chance to go to school. While many of us take school for granted, education in Africa is key for these children in gaining the future. Without school, they have no hope. No one should ever be put through this pain. So support the farmers. Don't use child labor and support the efforts to put these children in schools and out of danger. Don't stop eating chocolate.
Okay, don't stop eating chocolate, but have you ever stopped to wonder where your chocolate comes from? So when you ask the question, what is the structure of this particular society? Yeah, we live in a wonderful red state, blue state reality. However, when you pull back, we also live in a global reality that includes a lot of inequality. It includes a lot of stratification, all of that. And so I want you to begin to think about these issues, not just at your level, but also at the larger level. What is a society that has children that do this kind of work? And we will talk a little bit about child labor later on in the semester. One of the most important things to remember is that although we're different, we all kind of share similar patterns. And so external forces in the social world sit right on top of all of our lives, regardless of who we are. We're in the middle, and the norms of the society impact us. The group norms impact us, what people tell us we're supposed to do. The role expectations impact everyone. Some of us are mothers, fathers, sons, wives, students, employees, etc. We have to juggle all those roles. Everybody does that. Social expectations. Some of you are expected to graduate, get a degree, go to college, and all of those things impact you. So you see how all these forces are coming down on your lives? What about rewards and punishments? I mentioned earlier that I followed the rules, I didn't speed, but what if I did and a policeman was behind me? Well, that social pressure would impact me. I know I'm going to get a ticket, so I have to conform. Then, what about the organizational norms? Whether you're watching this class in high school or whether you're watching it on campus, you're probably dressed very similarly to everybody else because we have a kind of unspoken college dress code, jeans, comfortable clothes, maybe tennis shoes. And so those forces sit on top of you. Also, in your schools, you just can't get up and leave and go whenever you want to. You have to follow those organizational norms. And so all of these things impact us. And so we experience them a little different, but we're all still experiencing the same thing. And let me give you an example. Think about the person you marry. When you think about this, you think about how beautiful they are, and this was an individual decision, and you so love them. Well, what if I tell you that this decision is very much influenced by our community? First of all, your family. Many of us have to pass the family test. If mom doesn't like the person you bring home, then that's not going to be a good match. The family may not accept them. The family may even disown you if you bring home someone that is not appropriate. What if you're 20 and you happen to be walking through the campus and you meet this 90-year-old man and you're like, Mom, I love him and I want to bring him home. He's older than your great-great-granddad. Your family may not approve of that and may make it difficult for you to continue that relationship. What about your education, your diploma? Many people marry people of similar educational level. If you have a PhD, you're probably not going to go to a GED class to find a mate. You're going to look for people that have a similar background. That's why a lot of people end up getting married once they get to college. All right, what about the media? The media tells you who's attractive. All those people they parade up and down the red carpet lets you know that this is the standard of beauty. And many of us use those cues from the media to even decide who we're going to date. You know, before, I don't know what, 20 years ago, maybe 30, 40, maybe Jack LaLanne was the first, nobody freaked out over a six-pack. That wasn't like the most beautiful thing. Now, it is the most beautiful thing. Everybody's looking for somebody with a six-pack. Well, that's a new idea of beauty for us to look at. And this is also why, over the course of our history, models have looked in and out and in and out of different ways, heights, and all of that. And the media lets us know what's in fashion, what we should be looking for. Our religion also dictates who we marry. Our religion may say you cannot marry someone outside of your religion. If you are a Christian, would your family be comfortable with you bringing home a Satanist as your spouse? Will they accept that? Would they feel good about that? Or do you think you might have some trouble bringing someone home that's that different? Some religions even say, if you bring this person home, we have to kick you out of the religion. So not only do they mean it, they mean that you cannot even be a member if you don't conform to this norm, right? Social class. Your social class dictates who you marry, because just like your education, people tend to marry others with a similar social class. And so once again, Paris Hilton is probably not going to come to Dominguez to find a partner, just simply because she is way out of the general social class of many of the population here. Not everybody, but some. And so when you think about this, all of this determines who you're going to marry. And finally, the government. And this one may seem like, well, the government can't tell me what to do, but yes, they can. It wasn't until 1967 that places like Virginia overturned this policy that blacks and whites can't marry. It wasn't until the Loving versus Virginia case that the government said, okay, you all can all marry. But before that, there were rules and taboos against it. Right now, think about who the government is restricting. Gays. If you are gay, the government now has determined that you cannot marry. And so we're in the process of duking that out right now. So when you think about the sociological perspective and you think about that magnifying glass, I want you to consider how we study people and remember that you are part of the larger social order. So when you're looking at that magnifying glass at others, people can be looking at the magnifying glass at you and looking at why you do what you're doing, why you believe what you believe. And so I want to put up this picture, and I want you to think about what you see, and then we'll talk a little bit about what you see. So can we put up the image of the old lady and the young girl? Oh, well, I'm telling you the trick here. But look at the picture and tell me what you see. There are two images here. One of them is of an old lady. They call her an old crone. And one of them is of a young girl. And I want you to stop for a minute and take a look and think about which one you actually see. And so let's look at what the, first let's look at what the young girl looks like. This is her eye, and I'm going to do right here. And her eye is kind of looking away from you. This is her ear. And so if you see, this is her face kind of in a profile here with her eye looking away. I know that's really horrible, but it's the first time I'm trying to use this thing. So that's the young girl. She has like feathers up here. So you'll be able to see that. Now the old lady, this is her first eye. This is her second eye. I'm going to draw it out and then erase it. This is her huge nose. And this is her mouth. This is hilarious. And so when you erase it, you can see the outline now of the old lady. Well, this image, they use it a lot in psychology. It's very, very much like the social world. Because everybody looking at it may see something a little different. And some people, it takes a long time for their eye to adjust for them to see the other image embedded. We're all looking at the same picture. It's not changed, it's not moved, it's not altered in any way, yet two people standing in front of it can see something very different. And this is what we mean when we talk about social reality. Everyone's reality is not quite the same. There are multiple perspectives. And in sociology, this is why we have so many theories. Because all of those theories come out of all those different perspectives. Think about some of the different things that have occurred recently that people have seen very differently. The first one is Rodney King. And he always thought, you know, once you got the video, that's it. The video is clear, it's recorded, everybody's going to see the same thing. Guess what? They didn't. Their perspective before the situation determine what people saw in that video. And so when we think about social reality, everybody was looking at the same video, but everybody looked at it and saw something completely different. Let's take a look at Katrina and what occurred. Some people looked at Katrina and said, this is just pure racism here. They're doing this to these people because they are a minority. Well, some people looked at Katrina and said, this is pure government incompetence. Wouldn't matter who the people were, it's the government. And so they're looking at the same situation, but they're coming up with different reasons for what occurred. And so let's think about homelessness. Because we think about homelessness and, you know, we want to help homeless people and we really should give them money. Well, John Stossel, who always takes kind of like the other perspective, well, he gives you a different perspective on panhandlers and people that are homeless. So let's take a look at freeloaders. Sorry if you guys didn't hear that. You can kind of turn up your volume. But John Stossel was talking about the homeless shelters as, in essence, places for freeloaders. People who don't want to work, people who drop out. Now, aren't we supposed to have sympathy for homeless people? Aren't we supposed to understand? And here he is going through looking at how much free food we're getting. This is an example of people looking at social reality and seeing it differently. If you are from John Stossel's perspective, that all of these shelters, all of these food kitchens are just free handouts, he would not vote for certain social policies. If you're from another perspective that says, look at these poor people, they have maybe fallen through the cracks, we need to help them, then you will vote for a different kind of social policy. And this is what sociology looks at. How people looking at the same social phenomena like homelessness, panhandling, can interpret it very, very differently. And so we're a little bit halfway through, and I do want to take a break. And when we come back, we will continue our discussion, and I'll talk about how we're going to unfold the rest of the semester. So let's take a short break, and then we will be right back.
You are watching the competing television program service on California State University, Dominguez Hills.
California State University of Dominguez Hills, and towards the program of offense, program in the future. Also, I am in Spanish, and I love the atmosphere. In fact, I'm in the 7th grade. There is a really awesome place to feel like I'm home.
I took one of the distance learning classes recently for convenience, so it was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or if it didn't work out that way, tape it and watch it in my own leisure.
Well, I took the distance learning course because it's I'm able to watch videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that if you watch it at home or you drive the easter. And I would recommend this to a friend.
Hi everybody, welcome back to Sociology 101, The Individual in Society. I am Dr. Squires. This class is part of the General Sociology 101, and it's also part of the Young Scholars Program at California State University, Dominguez Hills. If you are a high school student with a B average or better, you can enroll in this class and the others for credit for 6 units of college credit for only $3.50. This semester, you can enroll in 4 courses. Music 101, Introducing Music on Mondays from 3 to 4:30. Theater 100, Television, Film, and Theater on Tuesdays from 3 to 4:30. Sociology 101, this class, The Individual in Society, on Wednesdays from 3 to 4:30. And CHS 100, The Americas, on Thursdays from 3 to 4:30 p.m. Enrollment for the Young Scholars Program is open until February 11th. If you'd like some more information, please give us a call at 310-243-2288. And welcome back to Young Scholars and also General Sociology students that are tuning into this lecture. And we are just doing an intro today, what we're going to cover during the class. And I'd like to start off with giving people this choice, because if you take this sociology class, I'm going to challenge some of your commonly held belief systems, some of your understandings of the social world. And I like to give the choice that was given to Neo in The Matrix. And so let's take a look at The Matrix. And you have a choice. Do you want to know what is social reality and how do sociologists look at this? If you do, then this is a class you want to stay in. So let's take a look at that clip from The Matrix.
Something. What do you mean you can't accept? want to know what it is. There are many voices in the room. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room, you can see the world out of the window. All you can know is happening. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been built on your eyes to blind you from the truth. You tell them. This is our last chance. After this, there is no coming back. Eternity you go. The story ends. You are completely dead and leave whatever you want. You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland. And I show you how easy your rabbit hole becomes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth. Nothing more.
Okay, Leon took the red pill. He wants to know what exists outside of the Matrix. And I would say to you, you live in kind of a Matrix. You live in almost a reality that's not a reality that is a reality. And so what do you want to know? And this is what sociology asks. What's really going on in the culture? Can we actually find out? I'm sorry that clip was kind of low, but you can go watch it on YouTube. Just type in the red pill and it'll come up. But what Morpheus says to Neo is that you're a slave. You have actually been in a prison created for your mind. And I argue in a way that your culture is very much like that. It determines how you see the world, what you see in the world, what is good and bad, and how you interpret what people do. So we do exist in a kind of matrix-like reality. And just like the Matrix, our perceptions of reality can change. Remember I said, what if you were a Christian and you brought home the sickness? Well, what if you were a Christian and you went through a conversion experience and you became a Satanist? Things that people would think are two completely opposite realities. One person can still experience that. And so for sociologists, this is what makes it fun. This is reality. And this is why there's so many theorists and perspectives. So chapter one kind of takes you through an overview of the sociological perspective. And a couple of things I want you to take note of. First of all, there's a lot of different levels of analysis. We can study the individual. And that would be micro, me and one person. We can study a kind of middle level, so we can study small groups or a small community. That would kind of be a meso level of analysis. Or we can study a city, or a country, or a state, or a larger issue. That would be a macro level of analysis. So when we think about sociology, we're not always all looking at the same point. You can look at the person, maybe their interaction, or maybe the larger situation they find themselves in. And that's going to determine what you see as well. A couple of researchers I just want to point out, August Comte said that, look, mankind has traveled through three stages. And he said, of course, we are at the highest stage right now, but the first stage is the theological stage. And in essence, this is God did it. Whatever happened in the world, God did it. The cross didn't grow, God did it. If the flood came, God did it. And so he said, this is how the first group of people kind of explained the world. The second stage he calls this the metaphysical stage. And this would be that budding stage of simple observation. If a leaf fell into the water and grandma died the day after, there'd be some correlation between that leaf falling and what subsequently happened. And so he said people in this stage, they were trying to understand the world, and they did it through observation and linking things together. So doing this would cause this from their observations. And then finally he says, look, we are in the last stage, and this is the scientific stage. This is the stage where we don't blame God. We don't do simple cause and effect observation. We actually do measurement and experiments and science and try to answer why questions. And so this is the contemporary stage of development. August Comte is considered the father of sociology because he's one of the early people that started to ask this question, what kind of society exists? And that's the question that sociologists have been answering ever since then. Another researcher I want to point out is Emile Durkheim. And Emile Durkheim comes from the functionalist school. And the functionalist school, they look for patterns and order in the society. So they say every institution, everything in society has a function, has a purpose. And Durkheim talked about the fact that we could actually feel kind of out of sorts with society. Society might lose meaning for us. And we'll talk about that in a second. But what Durkheim was looking at was how we all, in a way, agreed to get along. Think about California. Millions of people, yet it still functions relatively well. People move through the highways, go through the businesses, move in and out of the neighborhoods and the communities in a very relatively ordered way because we all agree to follow the rules, drive up the right side of the street, etc. This is what Durkheim was looking at. And he was writing in the late 1800s, early 1900s. So think about it. Durkheim was looking at the Industrial Revolution, the changes that our society was going through. And he said, you know, all of these things are going on in a pattern. And people are agreeing to those patterns. And what is interesting, just to go to Durkheim for a second, when he talks about the patterns of society, there are points when I said we can get out of sorts. Durkheim calls this anomie, where all of a sudden the society that you understand to be normal, you know the rules of how it works, is all of a sudden thrown upside down. A perfect example of this would be 9/11. After 9/11, we really didn't know how to behave. We didn't know, we kind of changed our patterns and our routines. We didn't know if we could fly, if we could drink water, if we could open our mail, were we going to be attacked at any moment. And even though many of us didn't live in New York, we kind of experienced that day. So I was in Missouri and I remember feeling lost. I was driving. And I'm listening to NPR, and I hear about the World Trade Center, and I think it's one of their stories until I realize that this is actually real, and these things are actually coming down. The next day, what happened? We basically sat there almost paralyzed watching all of this unfold. This would be a perfect example of what Durkheim means by enemy. The rules changed for Americans after 9/11. We didn't know what our place in the world was. after that, because remember, we were the superpower and terrorism never really hit our shores like that. But afterwards, we were now vulnerable like everybody else. And so Durkheim would look at something like this in terms of the patterns that people expect to go on in society. And think about one of the things, and we'll talk about this when we talk about deviance, but this order, these patterns, these norms that we go through are so important that we employ people to make sure we follow them. So think about the role of the police. The role of the police is basically to ensure that the societal norms are followed. And so that we don't get out of pattern, that people don't disrupt the order that we've all agreed upon. So let's take a look at a short part of the clip called A Nation Behind Bars. Because think about how many people we're pulling out of the society and putting in this institution because for whatever reason, they're not conforming. So let's take a look at that clip.
Thank you.
just wanted to introduce that to you because we're going to talk about this later in the population. Are we creating a prison nation? And think about the question from Mills, what kind of society are we creating? One of the things the young man in the car said was he wanted the dog, the picket fence, you know, that whole American dream. Well, how are we constructing our society? Is that dream actually a reality for many, many American citizens? And think about some of the things they said in that clip. Even in jail, there is order. Just because it's their deviant and they've been pulled out of our society, in jail they create their own society, and this creates another kind of social order. So when you go to jail, you have to learn the rules, you have to learn the expectations, you have to learn the norms, you have to learn the patterns of behavior. Just like anybody going into any kind of group or any kind of society. So during the course of the semester, we're going to pull this idea out in more detail. And think about something else and just deposit this in your memory now. They talked about the inmates going into jail and dividing up by race. Why would that happen? Why are the whites, the blacks, and the other groups separating themselves out by this thing called race? So this is going to come up a lot for us during the course of the semester. Just to give you another idea from Durkheim, and I believe they mentioned this in your book, because this is one of his most famous observations. Durkheim actually studied suicide. And remember I said, oh, wow, we're individuals and all of that. So we think of suicide as so personal, just like who we marry. However, Durkheim said, guess what? There are suicide rates for a particular society. Some people are more likely to commit suicide. You can look for patterns in the society that will tell you who may or may not commit suicide. And Durkheim looked at a couple of different groups. First of all, he looked at male Protestants who were wealthy and unmarried. And he actually found that these people had higher suicide rates. And he also looked at male Jews and Catholics who were poor and married. And he said this population actually has a less likely chance of committing suicide. So why would wealthy male Protestants be more likely to kill themselves and poor Jews and Catholics who were married be less likely? And so Durkheim said there's got to be something going on in the society that would lead to this pattern. And basically he said, look, the difference here had to do with the people who had the most social integration. The more connected you were with the people in the environment, the less likely you would be to commit suicide. And so what he found was, think about Protestantism. It's based on this idea of the individual. You are rewarded from God by your individual works. And so for that group and for males in that group, there is a lot of pressure on them personally to succeed. And so Durkheim says because of this, they would tend to commit more suicide just simply dealing with the stress. Jewish men and Catholic men who were married, even though they were poor, even though they had a lot of community hardships, had more social connections. And so those social connections, in a way, helped them not personalize their troubles so much, and therefore made them least likely to take their own lives. And so when you think about this, you can actually go, wow, something so personal like suicide can actually be related to my race, my class, my gender. The graph that was off is actually just a graph that shows the difference between males and female suicide rates. And in contemporary society, males commit suicide at higher rates than females. And white males tend to commit suicide at higher rates than anybody else. So why? If, as as a social group, white males are seen as the dominant, all of that, why would they have a higher rate than everybody else? Think about it in terms of pressure, individualism, social integration. That population is expected to succeed. They are expected to do well based on their worths. And if they don't, they tend to personalize it. Whereas when you look at women, women have more networks to talk through their troubles with. And so this is why we see a difference in the suicide rates. All right, think about it. Does society really just work in terms of harmony? And there are a lot of researchers that say absolutely not. Yeah, we have patterns, but we also have a lot of conflict. And this is another sociological theory. Think about this. We have a society where workers are exploited. We have a society where people take advantage of other people to take resources or whatever surplus from them. And so instead of looking at things in terms of how we get along and work in harmony, conflict theorists on the other hand say, look, how are we actually dealing with each other? Because it looks like we're struggling for resources. Some people have water upstream, the people downstream want water. Some people have money and capital and own resources, the workers want money, capital, and resources. And so basically, we are in this constant, you know, struggle back and forward. And so this leads into this discussion of Karl Marx. And Marx and Durkheim do not be opposite. You can't think of them like that. But they are looking at the society from two different magnifying glasses. And Karl Marx says, look, there is a lot of conflict. There's a lot of exploitation. So let's take a look at this cartoon, Big Box Art. And then let's come back and see how that would fit into a Marxist analysis. Corporation and their outsourcing. We now see the growth of Walmarts and all these mega stores. And how does that relate to what the little worker is doing? Remember, part of that little song says we used to be your customers and now we're your employees. So conflict theorists would say, look, this is not harmony. Nobody wants to work for, you know, half a minimum wage or whatever. There is a lot going on. And Karl Marx would have a word for it. He would say, this is what we see as exploitation. This is why we see the conflict of people picketing and rioting and all of these kind of union marches. Karl Marx says, look, the society is divided into two classes. The bourgeoisie capitalist owners, these are the money men, the people who own the things, have access to the means of production. And then the proletariat, the workers. These are people like me who come in, punch that time clock, and work for the money men. And Karl Marx says, look, this is not at all a harmonious relationship because those corporations want to get as much work out of me and pay me as little as possible. And I want to work as little as possible and make as much money as possible. And so how do we interact? And Karl Marx said, look, each of us are in pursuit of our own interests. And those interests do not converge. There's no way that that corporation can make all the money that they want in the world and still pay me all the money I want in the world. And so we're going to constantly have a conflict over resources. We're going to constantly have a struggle because things are not equally divided. And he says this proletariat, the workers, will continuously be exploited by the owners. And for Karl Marx, and this is down and dirty Marx, it's much more complicated than this, but he says, look, in order for any of this to change, the laborers, the people who struggle all day to make other people rich, he said, we're going to need a revolution. We're going to need to overthrow everything in terms of how we do labor, employment, and work. And so when you think about the society, Marx is looking at a very different society than Durkheim. In the Communist Manifesto, Marx says the history of all hereto existing society is the history of class struggle. So from the very essence of the social order, Marx sees conflict. Where Durkheim sees agreement and harmony and all of us following the rules. What is interesting here about Marx is he said that many of us exist in a state of false consciousness. In essence, we're being exploited, but we don't know we're being exploited. We actually believe somehow that that job has our best interests at heart, or somehow we're going to benefit and profit very well from the job. And Marx says it's because we don't see where we are. We don't realize that all of the workers are one huge exploited class. And until we all kind of understand that, we will never get equality. We'll always be looking at those people who own and in that struggle and in that conflict. And so what is really interesting is how these different groups, these different views of the society impact what they do in terms of research. During the course of the semester, we will talk about different people's research, but imagine what Durkheim would study in a society as opposed to what Marx would study. Durkheim would say, hey, let's look at who's doing what, who's benefiting, who's getting paid. Marx would say, hey, let's look at how they all agreed to kind of get along and function in this school or institution or whatever it is. Other research I just want to point out before we run out of time. Oh, actually, let me go on and finish this one thing about Karl Marx. And this class, Marx is interesting because not only did Marx influence academia, but Marx's ideas also influence the society itself. He's very unique. Most researchers don't have a following or like Marx. Most theorists don't. And his idea kind of spawned and was connected to and helped, kind of congeal the idea of a socialist society where we all need to work together, where we all need to share resources, where we actually need to get rid of those few that own and spread those resources towards everybody else. And this semester, if we can, I'm going to try to have a guest come in. Last semester, I had a member of the Communist Party come in. And so I'm going to try to see if I can get him to come into this class and kind of talk about what that belief system is. And what does it mean when you say that you are a communist or a socialist as opposed to a capitalist in contemporary society? I want to go to the one thing, and I want you to just think about this as you just think about how theories can influence the rest of the world. Let's take a look at the Berlin, a clip on the Berlin Wall, because there is an entire belief system that kind of emerged out of the ideas that Marx and others were espousing. But this is how the Berlin Wall is actually one way these ideas manifested in the society. So let's take a look at that next clip.
Dividing a city. Imprisoning its people. The very image of the Cold War, the Berlin Wall. On the morning of Sunday, August 13th, Berliners worked to find a divided city. Teams of workers under armed guards started erecting a barbed wire barrier through the center. The barriers split Berlin. Families were torn apart.
My father, the king of the others, in Tunis, they closed the border. It was incomprehensible. It was so strange. And then my mother came in and crying, and my elder sister, and we were thinking, how do we get the sister back? My sister bet Summer had stayed with my aunt just outside of East Berlin. So we were took the S-Bahn, and it was an absolute chaos. It was terrible. People crying, shouting. Some were frightened, some were angry. And I just remember I was so frightened. I thought, we'll never see my sister. She's lost, so to speak.
Three days later, concrete blocks began to replace the barbed wire. Along the suit of boundaries rose the Berlin Wall, carving the city in two. In the East, people risked death to flee from the last chase of the barrier.
All of a sudden, I saw my friend crying. I said to myself, oh my God, you're not going to make it.
He's done over here, thought.
But I flew home. I turned it on and I saw
him.
A lovely woman said to me, go, go, run too. You said, run. So I just started running.
Think about this, and we're going to come back to this. I kind of just want to introduce the topics today. But the Berlin Wall was just not a physical barrier. It was an ideological barrier. It was a social barrier. It was a cultural barrier, an economic barrier. But think about the ideology behind that wall. What are the consequences? And if it was communal, and would it ever work? Like I said, I'm not going to take a position, but if the idea, let's share, let everybody spread things evenly, why would you need a wall? to reinforce that idea. So there's a lot of things that we will ask ourselves and a lot of questions in the society. The difference between the East and the West was the difference in essence almost between night and day. Yet, they needed each other, played off of each other, and shared a very, very similar reality. I remember hearing a long time ago when I was in graduate school, someone say that it was very difficult to actually have pure communism within the context of a capitalist reality. And what I found interesting was later on, after the Berlin Wall fell, and, you know, everyone, all these things started to come out, they actually showed that there were some very wealthy people on the communist side. There was really a lot of capitalism going on, even on the communist side. And what was interesting to me was how it manifested after the wall fell was the rich people who were behind the wall got to wear red. They got to wear bright colors. They got to display their wealth, where before, when that wall was up, they couldn't do that. And so we're going to bring up all of these things. And so before we run out of time, I'm not going to touch on Max Weber today, but Max Weber is, he says we need to understand people's subjective meanings. And if we do that, then we can study society. It's not harmony, it's not conflict, it's somewhere in the middle. And so before we run out of time, I just want to recap for you guys what's going on in this class. And just to remind you, I actually had a serious medical issue come up. And so a couple of the classes, you guys are tuning in until we get the schedule correct for that. So keep looking on Blackboard. I'm going to keep things posted. And also, I will keep you updated with your TA information. And honestly, I am not quite sure how this semester is going to play out. And so I want to also let you know that there may be a couple of instances where the lectures for this class are pre-recorded. And so we didn't have any calls now today, but as we go on through the course of the semester, I want you to think about the topic and call in. You can ask questions, you can make comments, you can raise things that you have read in the textbook. So during the class, the phone number will come up. There's a question, how soon do we need the book? I'm being really flexible with due dates, so once I'm leaving the exams up for a long time, so I would say get it. You know, it's about 2 weeks into the real semester. You guys are just starting, but within the next week or so, I would say go ahead and get the book. And until you get it, check out the website. And check out the companion site, look at what they have there. That will give you a lot of information before you actually order the textbook. And like I said, I will go ahead and order just a few copies through the bookstore, because most people don't buy it through there anymore. Let me give you a few more things with the class. You will see in course lectures that I post some of my notes sometimes. I don't do it for every lecture, but I do it for some. Remember, the notes are copywritten, and so ask me if you're going to reproduce them or use them somewhere else. But these notes will kind of give you a guide of what we're talking about through the course of the semester. I will give you information on your exams. And I am getting the 1 minute mark, so it's almost time to wrap it up. This was our first day. And if you have any questions, any comments, or anything, just send it to us. It'll take us a second to get to you, but we will get to all your questions and comments. And so welcome to Social 1. If you are in the class, tune in again on Wednesday. And also remember, you can watch the class during archives. So I look forward to seeing you guys at our next class session, and take a last look at the textbook. If you have comments or questions or anything, please feel free to contact me. And read the bottom of the book. They challenge you on the cover to even consider how you would interpret that sociologically. And so I believe that I'm out of time.